I can't see anything. Would everybody please stand up? Would everybody please stand up? Nope, that doesn't help in the least bit. Everybody sit back down, and I'll stand up. Oh, that's where I'm supposed to be. Guess what? You can't get to where you want to go unless you know where you are. Simple thing, isn't it? Well, good morning to everybody. It's nice to see such a full house. This morning, I had to tell people to come forward a little bit because they were way back there, and I told them I didn't bite. And I don't plan to bite anybody. Anyway, so part of the quote was talking about lint, that we tend to look at lint on other people. Just like when I had everybody stand up, that didn't help me. I was trying to take the lint from everybody else so I could see where I was. It didn't work until I stood up and I could see. So this lint, if you've ever noticed, lint has a way of growing. Have you ever washed clothes and you don't just get one piece of lint, you get lots of pieces of lint, especially when a Kleenex tears inside and it just gets all over everything. Anyway, the lint of our lives tends to grow. First, we have maybe a sweater. Then the lint starts growing into a blanket. And then pretty soon the lint is so all over that we can't see anything but lint. But the lint. Because what are we focused on? The lint. And as long as we remain focused on the lint, we can't see what is happening right here and right now. And we can't appreciate where we are and what we are doing. Until that time, we can't make our way past the lint. Now, the lint isn't bad, isn't good. It's just that those things that preoccupy us. Sometimes they might be not having enough money, or it might be not having the right diet, or maybe there was an accident or something bigger that caused that lint. But as long as we stay focused on that lint, it grows and grows and grows. So how do we get that lint back down to where we can appreciate where we are right this very moment? Well, one of the ways we can get that lint back down is, well, of course, number one, treatment. That's what the church is about, right? Treatment. The other way, though, is loving where we are. Looking at the things in our life that don't have that lint covering them. Because no matter how bad things are, there's always areas of our life that are going good. There's always something in our life that is uplifting. But as long as we have that lint, we can't see it. So in order to find those things that are good, sometimes we have to take a step back, literally and figuratively. Take that step back so that we can look deep within and allow ourselves to see what is good. And you know why that good is always there? That good is always there because God loves us. God loves each one of us so much that it's absolutely incredible. There is nothing that we have ever done, nothing that we'll ever do, nothing that we are doing at the moment that can sway God's love. Not God's love. Maybe each other's, but not God's. Because God only sees love, only experiences love. How can you see something that is contrary to what you are? When I was a little girl, A little embarrassing, but when I was a teenager, there a lot of kids, it was 69, 68 and 69, and a lot of kids were starting to swear and say things, you know, and I imagine some of you have seen things written in the desks and stuff like that. Well, that didn't go on in my family, so I didn't see it. I didn't hear it. In fact, there was a word written on my desk that you can ask my husband. I had to ask him like 5 or 6 times what it meant, because it just wouldn't register what it meant. And I'm not going to tell you what the word is. It wasn't a very nice word. But it didn't register because I had nothing to experience it on. I had nothing for it to cling to, in a sense, in my system. So God's the same way. God has nothing but love. And so nothing but love can be seen, nothing but love can be experienced, nothing but love can give out, nothing but love can come back. So God doesn't judge us. We're the only ones that judge us and each other. We're the only ones that criticize us. Now, does that give us an excuse to do whatever we want in the world? Of course not. Because if you go contrary to that love, what happens? You start running into all these little things that start happening, which aren't very pleasant. The lint in life. And that lint starts growing and growing and growing. I told us a story a little earlier of my son. He was riding his bike. And before that, we were trying to get him out of the house. He was 18, 20 years old. We were trying to get him out of the house, you know. If any of you had had teenage boys, you know that can be a bit of a push. And we kept telling him, you know, you got to get a job. You got to find someplace out of the house that's yours, and so forth. And he kept putting it off and putting it off. And we even moved him out into the garage so the girls could have their own rooms. And so he was sleeping in the garage. He still didn't quite get the hint. One day, he was riding his bike, and guess what happened? His bike tire, because he wasn't paying attention to how tight he tightened it, fell out, his front bike tire. He went head over heels, put the gears through his mouth, ended up with 30 stitches in his face. And when he came home, he said, "You know what, Mom? I think God just gave me that 2x4 you've been talking about." And he moved out shortly afterwards. And he hasn't had an accident like that since. And so what happens is, as I said, that link gets bigger and bigger and bigger until we pay attention to it. Until we look at it and go, this isn't love. This isn't appreciation. This isn't compassion. This isn't truth. This isn't patience. This isn't the way I want my life to be running. What I really want in my life is that peace, that knowing that I am loved, that I am cared about, that I am part of something bigger than what I think I am. So Ernest Holmes has a quote here from Richard Living on page 273. And it says, "Life fills all space and spirit animates every form. But since you are an individual, even the spirit cannot give you the gift of life unless you accept it. Life may have given everything to you, but only that which is yours you accept for yours to use." So guess what? Even though God is love, even though we have been created from that love to be that love. And I'm telling everybody here right now, that's our only purpose for being here. It's not to learn. It's not to pay for some past mistakes. It's not to do whatever you think it might be. It's to love and give love. To be loved and give love. Be loved and give love. That's all that we're here for. And tell the truth, that's enough. That's a big enough job to get to that point. But God can only give you that love if you're willing to accept it. Again, anybody here with children, you ever try to give a baby a bottle of peas when they don't want them? No matter what you do, you can't force it down that mouth. They spit it out and you've got peas or spinach or whatever you've given them all over the place. Well, we're like that. We're like that. God tries to give us peace. And what do? We do everything opposite that. We create chaos in our lives. We create drama in our lives. In fact, many people don't think they're alive unless they're going through some sort of drama in their lives and having something wrong. Most of our conversations are even very difficult for us to manage if we don't have something to compare and complain about. Have you ever noticed that? We get in conversations with people, and what do we want to do? We want to tell them what's wrong with us, or what's wrong with the world, or listen to what's wrong with them, instead of going, well, what's right? What's right? And I know I was having a really difficult time with this, and so one day what I did was I decided I was going to do something different. So a friend of mine started complaining, and I said, hey, what are you doing for your next vacation? I changed the topic, changed it to something that was good. Not easy, because we are so geared for the other. We are so trained from childhood. You know, what's the first thing your parents tell you? Don't do that. What's wrong? And we're scolded, or we're told that something's wrong with us, or we're told that something is wrong with the world. So how do we come back? How do we accept the gift of life? How do we accept the gift of God? We have to love. We have to forgive ourselves. We have to forgive ourselves on a level that is deeper than simply saying, I forgive myself. That won't do it, simply saying that. You have to get to a point where you're down on your knees and you're begging yourself for forgiveness. It has to be what I call a soul decision, to decide that, yes, I'm going to forgive myself for what was in the past. I'm going to let it go because it no longer matters. The only thing that matters about it is it got me right here, right now. And that is it. That's all the past matters. It got you in these seats. It got you in this moment. Other than that, it doesn't matter. Now you might say, well, what about kids? I mean, I had a kid in the past. I still got to take care of the kid. But that still doesn't matter in the past. What happened with that? You're taking care of your kid right now. You're staying present in the moment. You can't appreciate the moment if you're not here. If you're not here. Now, Reverend Andrea told us a little story, and she was one of the founding members of this church a long time ago. And she told a story where she went to meet Thich Nhat Hanh in Paris. He had a retreat center there, and it was really beautiful. But she had been shopping before she went to the retreat center, so she had several bags with her and everything, and skates for her kids and that. And she gets there, and she gets in line with everybody else so that they can be first in, you know, and get to the rooms and get everything settled. And the monks started coming along towards these people and saying, put down your suitcases. But if I put my suitcase down, somebody might take it. No, that's not a problem. Put your suitcases down. Put your suitcases down and come have some tea with us. And some of the people kind of argued, and they said, you have arrived. You have arrived. Each one of you have arrived today. You're in the seats. You have arrived. Welcome. Welcome. Isn't that nice to think about? I'm here, I've arrived, and I'm welcomed. Amen. I'm greeted. Thank you. And so Ernest Holmes goes on in Thoughts Are Things on page 71 and says, it is impossible for you to receive what your mind refuses to accept. If you desire to receive more, you need to consciously develop the ability to mentally encompass it. You make your life mean, little, and limit it possibilities when you refuse to accept the whole gift of God. If you open your consciousness to the greater receptivity of the divine, to a large, enlarged concept of the good that can flood your experience, life will take you on a new and wondrous meaning. So last week I was down in Davis and I spoke to him on compassion in action, which I'm sure you got to talk about that too. And one of the things about the compassion in action is you have to do it. To start with, you have to do it. You have to be compassionate. But what is compassion? Compassion isn't pity, like some dictionaries put it. Pity tends to divide us from the other people. Pity separates us because it says, I'm better than you, I know more than you, I have more than you, etc. So I'm pity you. Sorrow can be the same sort of thing. True compassion comes from the heart. It simply is. And it doesn't require somebody saying thank you. It doesn't require a reciprocation so that you give somebody something, they give you something back. It doesn't require that you need to be acknowledged. Anonymous gifts of kindness are great. But these gifts of kindness is a way of helping us to open up our hearts to receive more. Now, there was a story I told last week, and I'm going to cut it down a little bit, but this woman decided she wanted to open her heart more for love and for compassion. And she was very concerned about some of the things that had been going on. So she decided that for one solid month, she would give some sort of kindness of compassion every day. Something. And she handed out cupcakes galore. She visited people. She just smiled and said hello to people. She did all sorts of different things. But her husband noticed a change in her. Noticed that she seemed to be friendlier. She seemed to be more compassionate and so forth. So he joined her. And they started doing these gifts of compassion or gifts of kindness together. And after a while, something happened at the very end. She said, we don't have to stop. I said I'd do this for 1 month, but why don't I do this for the rest of my life? This is so wonderful. Mother Teresa tells us the worst illness in the world is right here in the United States. And you know what it is? Loneliness. Loneliness. How much effort does it take for us to talk to somebody that we don't know? To talk to somebody who appears to be lonely? To say hi to our neighbor? Or just be there? I have a 90-year-old mother, and one of the reasons why I've been kind of not around is because I am spending time with my mother. She lives with us, and much of that time is sitting with her and watching TV and discussing it. And her mind is very sharp, and I think some of that is because she laughs a lot, she gets to talk about things, and she says Trump is contributing to it. It's always something happening. In fact, she said she's going to live an extra 5 years just to see what happens. Which I said, go for it. But, you know, otherwise, we could have stuck her in a home. She could be by herself. She was always a very quiet person. Never had a lot of friends in that. But I chose when my father died to change that. And there's been some rough times along the way, but there's been some fantastically wonderful times along the way too. I never come home to an empty house, which is great. You know, I have somebody that feeds the dogs. I don't have to do that. But compassion can be just that, just the sitting and being with somebody, holding somebody's hand, saying hello, holding a door open for somebody with their arms full. We never know what that can do, what a smile can do for somebody, or what a gift in other ways. I'll read you a little something about Butterworth, Eric Butterworth. You don't hear a lot about him anymore, it doesn't seem like. But Eric Butterworth has some wonderful things, and this is, the universe is calling. And when I was a minister, we had to study Eric Butterworth. And one of the things he says is, we have thought of God as one who could help if we took his troubles, our troubles to him, and unburdened them on his broad shoulders. But as I have said, don't take your troubles to God. God isn't into troubles. Jesus says, your Father knows what you need before you even ask. But God doesn't know of your lack. A need is a vessel to be filled, but a lack is a state of mind. God knows the need, and it is his good pleasure to give you the kingdom, but God can't change your attitude of lack. God doesn't sit up there in his billowy cloud heaven before a great panel of flashing lights watching your prayer requests cause a light on your name to flash on. Imagine God says, oh yes, there's a call from Eric Butterworth. He's been pretty good lately. I'll go down and help him. Maybe he adds, when I get to it. Prayer is not a way to turn on the light in God, but to turn on the light in ourselves. And God is that light. So that really gives us something to think about. A focus on God over the next month or so. Focus on God and what God would do. Focus on the love that you are and how you can share it with others through acts of kindness. Appreciate right where you are at this moment, because those goals are always going to be out there. And as long as we're always rushing to the goals, we'll never arrive where we are. Take a moment to arrive and be at peace with yourself. And if you'll please join me, we'll do a spiritual mind treatment to bring this into focus more. So there is only spirit. And spirit is love. Love in every form. Love that is so vast that I can't even start to imagine it. Love that is so complete that it fills my body with vibration as I think about it, and fills me with a light that enlivens me. I know right now, as for each person here, that God's love is within each one of us. There is not a person in the whole wide world that is without love. The lint may be covering things up, but I know I can uncover the lint within myself. I can wash it away with acts of kindness, with focus on what's good in my life. And I have so much good to be grateful for. So much good. I have family, I have friends, I have a home, I have a earth that supports me. I have air that breathes me. And as this love fills me, I can't help but want to share it. Share it in ways that I never thought were possible. As my mind opens up to new concepts, new ways of experiencing life, new ways of being at peace with all that I am, I have arrived. I have arrived. I am welcomed. I am here. I am present. And I am so grateful for this church, for this community, for everything that I can think of, because all of life is sacred, and it allows me to be part of it. And I now accept it as part of me. And I know that as I give thanks for this, every person here is feeling this gratitude, feeling this aliveness of spirit, feeling the truth of spirit, no matter what's going on in their lives. So I release this treatment into the law, knowing that it is done by me, through me, as me, and for me. And together we say, and so it is.